shipwrecks of the Baltic Sea. We've been diving a lot here in Turku area now, and there's beautiful wrecks and great stories related to these wrecks. And we did one episode about the shipwrecks in the Finnish lakes, mainly in Saimaa and some in Lake Pula, and some older wrecks in Rasebori, where I live. And I made a note, 95, that we should make a movie about the Finnish lakes. So 15 years later, it became true. And the leading idea when I asked Antti Tuuri that we should find a new, not a new, but something which haven't been used before about the lakes, not a documentary. It should be something that opens up the other space, like I had experienced when I was a child. And Antti started to study that, okay, we have to have, of course, the Finnish mythology as the basis for that. Also, Antti being quite a lot of or slightly esoteric man, he also said that every animal, every piece of even the soil and the existence have an emu, kind of a mother spirit or connecting spirit. So we should find something that really we could use as the circulation of water, something that we could tell that with. And he went to the archives, the Finnish library, or the Finnish literature archives, Suomen kirjallisuuden seura, and started to look at the good character that we could use. We all know, of course, Ahti and Bellamo, which are the god and the goddess of waters, and they are not new names, and in a way, and a lot of stories have been written, not only in Kalevala, but in other purposes as well, using Ahti and Bellamo. But we needed to concentrate on something that would a little bit more be a good use for a film, because film should be a story. It should start from somewhere and tell a story and make it possible that we can travel in a way. A nature movie, if it's not a road movie, can be very boring. It's just clips of animals, as we always, every one of you can look from Saturday at 6 o'clock in television. You have the same format where the story about one animal has to be about 8 minutes. That's the BBC Bible. We wanted to do something else, a story, a kind of a road trip, road movie. And Antti found this wonderful name, which is an ancient Finnish name, Ahitar. And he realized that actually Vellamo and Ahti, they have daughters and sons, that everyone has their purpose and mission. That actually every lake, every spring and every pond has a water spirit kind of guarding it and taking care of it. The job is to see that everything goes well, and all the living creatures and the spirits are in balance. Everything is fine. It's their job. And we thought this is a wonderful name, Ahitar. It sounds really ancient. It sounds Finnish, but at the same time, it sounds international, that we can use this for all the, even the international versions. Really, the basic myth is from Finnish mythology. Of course, we have adapted, being filmmakers, we adapt them. But I really fell in love the idea that there is a water spirit that is born in a spring, and it will take its time in the spring, and when it's ready, it has to start traveling, and it has a mission, it has to do something. And this was the leading idea, and let's look a short clip where we introduce the spring and our main character, Ahitar, And so you get the idea better than when I'm trying to explain it. It's slightly demanding, trying to operate everything with one hand. Actually, I'm going to jump a bit further because we don't want to see the opening credits. We'll go straight into the subject.
The never-ending cycle of water is the basis of all life. In Finnish mythology, Vellamo is the goddess of water, and Ahti, the guardian of all waters. Ahti and Vellamo's daughter, the tiny water spirit, Ahitar, is forever reborn in the bubbling spring water. Different plants and animal spirits. According to the tale, water spirits grew up in the springs and learned to take care of the water folk. When the water spirits were old enough, the winter sky was lit up by northern lights in celebration.
So the difficulty in our concept was, of course, that how can you express, how can you try to move your own emotions when you have experienced something? Not by telling that, wow, this feels really good. How can you make, in a movie, find a subject, how you can tell something that is not physical? I mean, ahitar. You feel her, really, when you go into this spring, which is the biggest spring in Finland. It's a bit difficult to try to give her a voice. I actually tried it. We spoke to Antti that maybe she's a character that tells us the things that, you know, what is her mission and how she's feeling. And we wrote a text to that, and I tested it with a couple of actresses, and I really loved Ina Kuustonen to talk as Ahitar, but I didn't believe it myself. I said, wow, she's not talking to me when I'm diving, definitely not using words. So I chose another way, because to transfer your emotions, if you're an author and you write a book, it's quite easy in a way. You can prescribe, you know, your how it feels, and the audience in a way, or the reader starts to relate to those emotions. But in film, it's a bit pretty difficult when you don't have human beings that can express emotions with their gestures and faces. But of course, music is such an abstract element, and it kind of passes through your conscious, and it can be a good way to transport your own emotions, or the emotions you would like the audience to feel. Then I, of course, had been working already quite a long time with Panu Aaltio, my composer. We've worked in many movies, and he came with the idea that what if Ahitar is, she's just a female voice without words, and it helped a lot, because then we could easily express the feelings we wanted to have when we show places like this. And then she's kind of telling the story. We don't need words when we talk about what a spirit or spiritual experience is in this world. So these are the main elements. Of course, we need a spectacular place and something spectacular to happen. And we spent in this big spring in Hollola for almost 3 years. We went back and forth. It was, of course, exciting, as you can see, the kind of the growth, the plants making tunnels. It's really the exciting world for small boys, which we still are. But there was not a lot happening. We had a big problem. How can we tell this, that the water spirit is born there? The water bubbling from the ground is not enough. We never got the really good material. We came back every season, winter, summer, spring. Was always great and fascinating, but it never looked exactly what we could use. And we had a lot of versions, but we never felt there's this Ahitar. Doesn't look really like. But then one day, I think it was in the winter, or the darkest time of the year, maybe November or December, we came there, and this funny mist was rising from the bottom. Wow, now it's happening. And we spent just one day filming the mist, and it never came back anymore. We never saw it again. It was just this one time during these 3 years. And the same evening, Antti Tuuri called me and said, hey, I have an idea. Could you find something, you know, like a mist coming, or maybe a mist on the surface of the water that we could use as Ahitar? Yeah, I'll send you a couple of clips. What do you like about this? We just shot it today or yesterday. So the problem solved. And of course, it even made stronger the feeling of wow, there's, now we have passed the test that the spirits accept us. The 3 years of trying with all kinds of things, and then you just come there, oh, we can't, this doesn't look anything, and then it happens. And the same happens for the fishes, really. There was one day, it was there, we were already editing, and we had a version of the material, but something was missing, and then this was March, the last year of shooting, and we came there, and the fish were acting strange. They were just waiting for something, and so Teemu went down there with a system that doesn't make bubbles and stayed there, of course, for me, following him with an open circuit system which makes bubbles. So I thought, okay, I have to go away so that we don't scare the fishes away. But we normally have a safety diver for somebody who is working, and with his closed circuit system, we are not connected with telephone, which in the open system, we can talk to each other and we can talk to the surface, but he can hear in his system, but not talk. He don't have a microphone in the system. So he just stayed there for hours, and I was then watching from the surface that, okay, he's not moving. Of course, he was just holding the camera and doing so slow movements that through the water, I couldn't see. There's a light in his system that is blinking. I couldn't remember what the blink, does that blink mean? It doesn't operate. So I thought, okay, let him film. So I cannot interrupt. If he's filming, if he's dead, I can't do anything. So I'll just wait. Then he came back and said, now we have the material. So it took him another 3 days, and we could finish this scene. So the basic elements for making movie and trying to tell your story are that you have to have a story that really you feel yourself that this is a way to tell how I feel when I see or experience something. Then you have to have a lot of luck. And then you have to have a lot of technological things and a way to do it. We can take a look at a couple of making of clips, but later on, because it really sometimes destroys the great feeling of seeing a shot when we saw how it's done, how much technical things not in this form, because we cannot build anything underwater in this type of movies, but anyway. But the elements that we have are just trying to capture the moments. If the water spirits and the water goddesses allow us to capture the moments, and then trying to really find the right moments which are important to you. And the next clip we're going to see is exactly the moment I was looking for. As I told, my first dive, there was everything you need in this life to live all through your life, to just hope that you could feel it again, clear water and sun rays. That's everything. So we worked a lot to capture that scene, and I explained it to Teemu so many times. Yeah, I've heard your first time when you got your mask, and don't tell it anymore, at least not in the press conferences, because he had heard it. Every time we go there, we should get the picture, you know, when the first, I know it, but when the moment comes, we'll make the shot, and I'll have it here because we got it. This is exactly what I saw, and of course, this looks much better, but this was the feeling. And what do you need? Just good luck, music, and some support from the water spirits.
Shrouded by mist, Ahitar inspects her new home.
Yes, as said in the text, the whole mythology and the spirits and the gods in the forests and in the waters, they were a way for the ancient people to explain things. Not to give an explanation why things happen, or not only for the to explain why things happen, and but also that there is always a reason why things happen. And I think this is the basis for the whole, a lot of mythologies, and especially the Finnish mythology, that it was a way of teaching, not teaching, but the way of teaching. That telling a story where there is a spirit or a god teaches or teach the ancient people respect towards the nature. Stone is a holy thing. Don't mess with it. Or there is a spirit in the water, or this water is holy. We have a lot of holy lakes in Finland. Pyhäjärvi is the most common name for a lake in Finland, I suppose. They are everywhere. And a lot of other words that we've lost the track are also somehow related to the holy things and or into the nature religions that the Finns had. But it was an important thing, and we know that the most important thing in the nature is equilibrium, balance, and the myths and the way to respect because of the water guard or the forest guard or the spirits need to be pleased. It was a way to protect the environment the people lived in. There's a lot of stories that how they behaved. For example, a lot of Finns, they used to throw bones before they decided whether they go fishing or hunting. So if it pointed to the lake, okay, we have to go fishing. Okay, we have to go hunting. Well, it's kind of a nice balance, 50-50. And a lot of other ways of making people to respect and understand protect their environment in order to survive. Then, of course, there are wonderful stories about tribes, especially in Karelia, where they really had holy animals as well. It's the kuikka, which is black-throated or a dipper or great northern diver. The beautiful black bird, which I have filmed quite a lot in Tale of a Lake, which has a sharp nose. And that was a really useful holy animal, because I've heard about a group of Karelians who believe that's the most holy animal and can protect the whole village against the enemies. And they used the tip, the nose, for their, what do you call this? I'm starting to get tired, so I'm losing words. For the weapons. And when the situation got really bad, that they were afraid they might lose, they took the holy bird to help them, and they actually had made hats out of the great northern divers, and they put on their birds, their heads, and attack the animal, the enemy. So I believe if a group of this kind of soldiers would come and attack, anyone would escape to see that, whoa, what do they have on their heads? And so there were funny beliefs also, but it was all to protect them and to make the people understand that there has to be the balance in the nature. And I don't have to ask that, is there a balance in the nature today? So we know the answer. But since we are actually getting to halfway, I was thinking that we could, if you want to ask or discuss about this subject, of course, Tale of a Lake is an important movie for me, and it has a lot of the elements that related to the theme of today, but I still have other things we could go through and see a little bit of the making of, the working, and the fun of of the adventure side. But is there any questions, anything you would like me to go into more details or?
Ulla. Mä pidän tästä.
Okay, what a wonderful word. I think I cannot even imagine how it is, what kind of experience it is to be there. It's so rich. But I have one memory. I once saw a short film, and there were two persons in Sauer. They were around 20 years old, and they were twins. And they were playing with the shower curtain. So we have been 8 months in our mom's uterus. So maybe that element is something very, very, very near human beings. So what can you tell the experience to be there?
Yeah, there's a lot of, since diving is in a way the technical diving, which means that using equipment is quite young. There was only the diving bells that in the 18th century onwards were used for mainly rescuing the cargo or the canoes from the shipwrecks, from the sailing boats or military boats, like Vasa boat. If you go to Stockholm, the Vasa Museet, which is one of the most exciting museums in the world for me, you can see that there is a diving bell. They just put a guy down there who wrap ropes around the canoes and they lift it up. That so the technical diving actually, the whole thinking or philosophy behind diving is pretty young. There's been some philosophers who've been thinking about this. One of them is a scientist called William Beebe, because he was a scientist who wanted to study the oceans, and he made this bathysphere, which is like a round diving bell, and was the first human being to go half mile down, so very deep, almost a bit less than a kilometer. And he thought that, wow, this is the future of the mankind. He actually wrote 1923, I believe he published this book, and he wrote, diving is the future for the human beings and this planet, that in the future, everyone will be spending their holidays underwater, etc. And he forecasted that. He was also, earlier he was a pilot. Flying will never have any meaning for the human being. It's just a useless thing. Let's forget it. There will never be anything commercial around aeroplanes. He was not exactly right, but he was studying a lot, and he had an idea that actually, due to our past, which he thought, since we've come from the oceans, well, the whole life has come from the oceans, we have we eternally are always missing back to the water. And of course, when we were just two cells, we started our way in the water, and it is important, an important element. And I was lucky to youngest daughter who was born underwater, and it was quite an experience, because she just came out and started to swim like a small dolphin. And I, of course, my wife did the job, and I did the excitement and the stress part. And then when she came, she just was swimming there, and I asked the nurse, hey, what's going on? How am I going to catch her? Don't worry, she's still with the umbilical. And everything is fine. She's not breathing. Let her take it easy. And then she came, slowly lifted her face and started to look around. No crying, nothing. And I said, she should be crying, shouldn't she? Because all the three earlier ones had been crying like hell when they came out. Oh, no, she's fine. She will start crying soon when you lift her up, and that happened. So it was a natural element for her. And we are, of course, mammals, and we know that, well, mammals were actually not originally from the sea On the contrary, they were animals from the land who started to find better places of survival close to the seashore, and some of them realized that, wow, it's a better idea to stay there because it seems that everything outside of the water is going crazy. They were clever, like whales and seals, etc. But we have this inside us, I believe. You're exactly right. Yeah, we have the eternal longing in back to water.
There are some questions in the Zoom. Let's see.
Okay, there are three questions already here in Zoom. Two of them have to do with the questions of the kind of production of the film. Maybe we can take those later. Yeah. One of them has to do with mythology. And the question, I read it here. My question is about the difference between Finnish mythology and then the mythological creatures and spirits of Sampi. Do you know about that, or have you considered making something in that narrative framework?
Well, I don't know that well, the mythology of Sampi, but I know that once you see a creature like that, it immediately relates to some quite creative thinking about mythology. It has to have a lot of stories and myths behind it. I'm not a specialist that much in mythology, but I know that we've, in the Finnish mythology, we have a lot of myths, maybe similar to Sampi, related to other fishes. This big fish that used to live in the Finnish rivers as well, called Monni, that they grew really big. The biggest ever caught in Finland was 186 kilos. 2 meters long, but they were, of course, they were killed out by the end of 19th century. But earlier, I think a lot of these myths about the monsters in the rivers, or monsters in the swamps, or the small lakes were related to these fishes that were big. There must have been, I mean, they still live in Siberia. There's a lot of them in Russia. And they can be really 200, 250 kilos, and they look really scary. If you go in a small river, clear water, and you see one 2 meter long, really strange animal, there must be a lot of meats. But I don't know really. The Finnish mythology is very, very rich and fragmented. We're happy to hear later on a specialist talking about folklore today, but a lot of them, of course, have disappeared because there's been a lot of small tribes or villages that have had their own stories, but I believe it could be that all the underwater myths, they are in a way similar. There are water spirits in South America, and there are water spirits in Indonesia, and they are kind of universal stories and part of the human knowledge which we have had and still hopefully we'll have one day. Somebody.
Okay. Yes, we will. Oh, yeah.
Thank you. I will try to keep it short. My name is Ruth Ilman, and being a scholar of religion, I tagged on very much to this water as the primal element of human beings. And I'm a very keen swimmer myself, and I'm convinced that having a lot of water around you everywhere is a very, very strong existential experience. And if you think about religious rituals that include water, we have them in almost all religions, and many of them are based on the fact that you should immerse yourself in water on all sides of the body. For example, in the Jewish ritual part, the mikveh, the idea is that you should immerse yourself 3 times so that your head is underwater, that your feet don't touch the ground or the bottom of the pool. And similar also in Eastern Christian traditions with the baptism, that you should immerse yourself totally and have water on all your sides. So I do think there is some kind of existential element in that.
Yeah, it's so you close yourself, I mean, you're inside liquid, and we're not actually meant for that. You can stay there forever, but you won't breathe a long time. I've had some studies, especially my time in the Navy divers. We had actually there has never been an accident that led to death in the Finnish Navy diver school. But there was one case where this guy simply ran out of air and he had no other way. He couldn't come up fast enough. He knew he had to inhale water, and he knew that he would be taken up because there's always the single rope, but it will take too long. And so he inhaled water, and he said later on, he told that, "Actually, I felt so good." It actually transports, because inhale or breathing is not because of we need oxygen. It's because we need to get rid of carbon dioxide in our body. And even the water takes it out from your lungs, but we don't have muscles to breathe out water. But there's a wonderful book which I suggest you to read. I'll tell it about later, because my last clip is related to that. So we come back to it. Any more questions?
Well, if you want to have a little pause, I have a little comment.
So, yeah, I don't need a pause, but it's good to go on. I realized that I was afraid this is very short, but we are halfway, and actually I'm halfway on my notes, but if you have questions, I'm happy to, or comments, please.
Oh yeah, I had a comment. Seeing on your telephone lake, I haven't seen the whole movie, but even the fragment was really, I think you managed to leave it open to the viewer to add their own stories, as we heard here. And in my mind, I was thinking all the references from the visual history of Finnish nature at all, and it came to my mind also the some contemporary art also, but thinking, for example, Ritva Kovalainen and Sanni Seppo's book called Puiden Kansa, Tree People, and then also thinking of Sanna Kannisto's photography work, and also Elina Majuri's underwater photographers. So I think you really inspired the viewer to find the connections, and I think that's lovely.
Yeah, thank you, because it's always out. As a filmmaker, wonder that could it be possible to make a movie which don't tell what you should think? And actually, I have a clip of Nature Symphony, which is Telva Lake was not my last movie. It's the Nature Symphony, which is kind of it's not a separate movie in that sense, but we've connected a lot of the archive and everything we've been shooting and the music from our previous movies. And of course, we shot more and we, Panu Altio composed more, but the idea behind it was that could it be possible, and so that the audience actually tells the stories, not the filmmaker. And I was really happy to hear that it did work, because I been in festivals and screenings with the movie, and I think several times, one in Germany was the last one, when one from the audience said that, it was wonderful. But why did you stop the most exciting story in the middle? You stopped it too early because it hadn't finished. And I said, do you know why? Because it was your story, not mine. And I didn't have any more material. She was, one of the elderly lady was really angry to me that this was not fair, that you started a story and then right when it was kind of being there, you started a new one. So that's whatever you create, or when you see a movie, you kind of reflect yourself into it, and it's different for everyone. And so maybe we will look at the clip from Nature Symphony when we spoke about this. It's really a movie without a word. And it's different from my other nature movies, because you don't see a track of human beings in my movies, because I make sure that there's nothing that shows that we are also there. In my view, we might see us as an outsiders. I left one sign in Tale of a Lake as well, and I will have that in Tale of a Sleeping Giant, Tunturin Tarina, which is coming. but it's not on this planet. We see, we can't help, we see the satellite and it's on purpose, but nothing else. But in Nature Symphony we see, because it's not about nature, it's about experiencing it, and slightly different, but let's take a look at a clip of that. Yes. So this is kind of it's a concert, it's a symphony, but at the same time it's like a live concert with nature shots. And actually, what a pity, because the first live performance of this movie on big screen or several screens and live orchestra was supposed to be next week here in Turku with the Turku Symphony Orchestra and Johanna Kurkela, but due to the situation it's transferred to next year. So let's hope the situation is better and we can enjoy this at the Linna Puisto, which would be a wonderful place for a live concert. It's really like 100 people, orchestra and choir and the film on the big screen. So it's possible just to take out the words and everybody tells their own stories. That's how mythology also develops, that okay, they told it's like this, but I felt it's not like this, it's like my story. And this is of course why there are so many myths and stories, and it's not only Kalevala, there are much, much more. I think the Finns don't talk that much, but they think a lot. And especially in the nature, you know, we have problems with the foreigners who we take to our summer houses and they start talking, you know, and asking stupid questions. They should be quiet and it's all there, you know, I'm talking in my mind. And it can be frightening. I heard this when I showed the movie it was in South Korea and was in cinema distribution, Tale of the Forest, and the buyer was so excited. He, it's incredible, where did you get the animals? And I said, what? Then where did you get so many animals? I said, they live in the forests. We go there, we spend years. Really? I said, yeah, you're welcome. Come here, come to Finland. No, it's too frightening. I had to be there with the animals. No, I'm not coming. He thought it's frightening, and don't leave an Asian people alone in the summer cottage. They will be so scared. And I said, well, actually you won't see the animals because they run away when you cannot be quiet. Okay, there was and I know that a lot of people want to see how we do things. So let's take the excitement part. I show a couple of clips about the making of. One is ice diving, because that's fun. That's actually my the only only reason why I still want to dive with equipment. It's otherwise it's so boring and just hauling the equipment. But in the winter time, it's great. It's simple. You just go there with a snowmobile or car or whatever and put on the gear, go down, and nobody is starting. Well, when you go from this hole, everybody comes back from the same hole. So it's very exciting. I love ice and the look of ice. So here's a short clip. Sorry about the music. This is made for one of my speeches in China. So the music is quite made for that audience. So we can keep it low now, not at least not too loud. So it's really great exhibition of modern arts. The last shots were done outside of Pori on pack ice, and we had 27 meters of ice on top of us and just these nice caves under it. And there's unbelievable formations, and you can see really a nature's modern art exhibition down there. So it is wonderful. Then another one, which is from a fiction, just to show that sometimes this is really, there's a lot of technology involved in underwater filmmaking. This is from a fiction movie, Pioneer, where we shot, because the story took place 300 meters below the sea level. It's about the true story about the oil rigging in Norway. So we had to build the oil plants and the diving bells and the whole underwater world of in the sea bottom. So we did build that in Iceland. But you see that there's sometimes a lot of technical equipment. Yeah, we have about 15 minutes time, so I was thinking to share a couple of thoughts, no answers, but maybe questions, because what of course, working a lot in the nature, and I practically spend all my life in the nature. I hate cities, I have to say. I hate flying, I hate traveling, but sometimes you have to do this. No question, we have to travel. I love traveling by train, and there you can at least see the nature, you know, from the window. And some questions that I always, when spending a lot of time between the filmings, waiting for the weather to change, because despite it looks like we're doing a lot, we're mainly waiting, you know, the storm to finish, or the snowfall to end, or the ice to freeze down, or whatever. Or you have a lot of time to think, and being there alone somewhere where there's no sign of humans, you really start thinking, looking around at who's the king. Because our biggest problem is that we really, not only Trump believes that we are the kings of the world, we will show the planet, we will show the nature, we will show the water spirits and the other that we rule the world. But do we really? Probably no hands rising for a question like this, but still we behave like we are. Even we, on my team, when we go somewhere, we go there, we believe with all the know-how and the technology, we can get the best shots, we can do this, you know, but no, we won't be able to do it unless we behave in the right way and we have the right stars, or we are lucky, whoever, whatever you call it, or you have the water spirits behind you and you are humble, then you can see wonderful places. In my next movie, this Tale of a Sleeping Giant, I saw a place which is really exciting. It's really strange, weird, and a bit frightening as well, and you really respect it, because the previous team from Finland who was working, not working, diving there, only three of the five came back. They are the Plura Caves in Norway. They are beautiful, they are wonderful. We spent there quite a lot of time filming some scenes, what the mountains, I mean the fjells, the Finnish tunturit, looked like inside, you know, that there are veins, there are minerals, there's the blood of this planet, water running through, and it has a meaning. But you have to be, not go there like showing that we can do whatever we want, and we have the technology and the know-how. It's not that we are the kings, we are the humble servants, or we should be. Any comments at this point? Because we are closing the end, I still have two clips, it seems. One is, I want to share with you a little bit about the coming movie, Tale of a Sleeping Giant, Tunturin Tarina, and then finish this with a slightly different underwater clip.
There are a few comments here in Zoom.
Okay, maybe I'll take the questions and comments from the Zoom chat now, so we won't forget about those. One comment. We already know that people living near sea are healthier than others living without the nearness of water. In UK, there was a study about it. I'm a passionate wild swimmer, and it's almost a dependency to get into the water every day. Best medicine, blue health is important. This was a comment.
Thanks for the comment. I also, every year, go and dive in the same place where I was for the first time, just to make sure that I'm still alive. Nothing has changed there. It's just that I realized that, whoa, my years are limited, but it has been 6,000 years, no change at all.
A question. Along with the absolutely beautiful and deeply emotional and impactful images, as a native English speaker, your English speaking voice artist is brilliant and brings a wonderfully honest dramaturgy to the material you have shown. Who is this voiceover actor?
Oh, for the Tale of a Lake English version, actually we've worked together in many, many films since Underwater Iceland. He is Jonathan Hutchins. He's lived in Finland for 40 years and has understanding about the Finnish language and mythology. So we adapted actually the Finnish version into international together with him to English. And yeah, he has a wonderful voice and he's an elderly gentleman and kind of we can hear it that it's not a boy telling the story. He must know what he's talking. Well, the Finnish version was told by a boy from my perspective, Samuli Edelman, but he's otherwise a deep character and I've known him since he was a boy, so he's a grown-up man now.
Then there was one question, it came before, I think it was more about the tale of the lake, and it has to do with a soundscape or the musicscape. That was quite overwhelming, and the question is that did you ever consider a more silenced solution for that film?
Yeah, I got a lot of critics for using too much music. There are people who would prefer listening to the nature sounds, but when you're making a movie, you have to decide, and it's actually the post-production is hectic, and sometimes you feel, okay, I have to do this, and I don't know what to do for this scene, and then you make a decision, maybe music or effects. Then, of course, when you look it again, you might realize, that, whoa, why did I choose that? So it's a difficult question, and there's a lot of opinions, but for me, music interprets the emotions, and maybe as a filmmaker, I have had doubts for my audience that maybe they don't get the same feeling, so we better put some music. And then the third is that I'm such a great fan of Panu Aaltio. He really can kind of adapt the emotions, what I have or the team has, from the certain scenes into music. But I will keep that in mind for my next movie. Actually, it's going to be slightly different from the sound and music design. But I'll keep that in mind. There will be some silence. But for the, of course, I'm showing a lot of promo material now, and this, then you have to have some music. But I'll keep that in mind. There will be more silence and nature sounds in the next one. Okay, then we'll take a look at a bit material. This is preliminary material, which we don't normally share with any audiences, but especially if it's in other than live, this is a short, early promo, again, with music. Tale of a Sleeping Giant. So this is not meant for the audience, but to give an idea what kind of environment we're working right now. Okay, I think we have to finish soon, but I promised to say a couple of words about the book. I can't remember any what connection it was, but author, Japanese author Kobo Abe wrote a great thriller, eco thriller, I think early 70s or late 60s. It's called the Interglacier Period 2. And has a really like a dystopic vision how what is going to happen when all the glaciers melt. And this, he really wrote this, and he's not a scientist, he's an author, about the world when the glaciers melt and there's no more land left. What's going to happen to human beings? It's really also one of the books that had a lot of meaning to me. I read it when I was 14. I'd always wanted to do something related to that, and my daughter, who studied to become a dancer, wanted to do her, or had to do her final choreography and dance to finish the studies in the academy, and she came to me one day and said, I've been thinking to make an underwater dance. And I said, whoa, if you want to make it really difficult, do it under the ice. And I gave her the book and said, do you have an idea? And she said, yes, I haven't been thinking, what are we going to do as dancers? How we dance if there's no more ground, there's land, that then there's only water, that how could we dance? And I said, read the book, listen to this music. I like this. I a long time ago wanted to have this piece of music in one of my movies, but it's by Vangelis. He's never going to get the rights. Listen to the music, read the book. So I didn't hear anything from her in 3 or 4 months. And then she called me, I'm ready. When do we shoot? Okay. I had just been operated. I wasn't able to dive. My DOP was also unable to dive because of sinus problems. So we said, okay, we're going to direct from the surface, and you have to do this alone, of course, with my team and cameraman. And we did an underwater dance. It's called Noste. Well, some of you might have seen it. It was slightly alone from it in the Eurovision Song Contest in Jerusalem, or Haifa, wherever it was, Tel Aviv, a couple of years ago. They used, because my daughter was dancing there, they used her idea. And so let's finish into that, because this is really, I think, a good melting pot for all the arts and all the elements we have. All the 4 or 5 elements, depend how you calculate it, and music and dance and the underwater world. So on my behalf, I thank you, and sorry about using 8 minutes extra time, but it's been nice to talk to and with you. Before I run the clip, I have to tell that then when this was edited and we knew that, and the record company and the managers told that, well, there's no chance we get rights from Vangelis. I was disappointed, but I told my producer that send this to Vangelis and ask. And we got an answer, yeah, of course you can use it. And just a nominal payment, it actually was, he liked it, so we didn't steal it. Thanks for Vangelis.
Thank you, Marko, the most beautiful ending of your Agora talk. And I would also dare to say thank you for your lifetime commitment to underwater worlds that you share with us through your films. Thank you. And the time went really fast. Now it's time for lunch break, and we will continue at 1 o'clock here, and at the Zoom too. Enjoy.